Welcome to This Week in Missouri Politics. This week from the state capitol, we're broadcasting on Federal Inauguration Day here in the capitol. We're joined by the Senate Majority Leader, Senator Caleb Brown from Columbia. Welcome back to the show.
Good to be here.
Let me start off. You know, it's an odd feeling in the capitol today. The House is gone for other reasons, but outside there's more police presence. The federal inauguration came and went and is over by the time we're doing this interview. What were you concerned coming in the capitol today?
No, we weren't. You know, we had had ongoing conversations with FBI folks, law enforcement around. They had kept us abreast of what they were hearing, and there just was never any credible, at least here, it was never really any credible threats, anything they were worried about. So we felt, we had a caucus call on Friday dealing with the safety, but also the COVID stuff, and everybody just said, hey, let's come and do our work.
I didn't even see anybody protesting today, maybe one or two people.
I didn't see anybody. They may be out there, but I haven't seen or heard anybody.
Capitol Observer Brian Grace said he spotted two people, and he said, tell his mom he's fine, you know. let's talk first about the election, how it came out. I mean, obviously, I think Trump ran better than anybody thought. But at the end of the day, I'll ask you the question I've asked a few other Republicans. Do you think Joe Biden won the election?
Joe Biden won the election. You know, there's always fraud and there's always irregularities in elections. I think you in an election where, you know, 160 million votes are getting cast, that's probably going to happen. But, you know, I think all of the various litigation that happened, they did a bunch of it, went before a bunch of courts, many Republican judges, many appointed by Trump, and the outcome was the same. So you have to respect the process and you have to move on. I don't think it makes you any less patriotic if you decide that it's time to move on. I think it makes you believe in the foundations of the Republic the way it was designed.
Well, you had some folks that had, it felt like sour grapes, but you had a few folks that when you, because of COVID, people voted differently. In Missouri, you could vote differently. And when you do change how you vote, there's gonna logically probably be some issues with that. I think it's rational to sit and look at what happened and can you improve on it?
Absolutely, and I do think, you know, Missouri's always, we've had good elections. We know our results relatively early in the night. And even this one where there were mail-in ballots and absentee ballots in a bunch of different places, the process still ended up being about the same. The result was the same. And so, you know, I think it's time that we can talk about ways to improve the system without you know, trying to burn down the system.
So President Trump left office earlier in the day from when we're doing this interview. He had a bunch of pardons on the way out. He didn't pardon Joe Exotic, which I'm personally disappointed in. But I thought it was interesting. A lot of Republicans kind of looked at his law and order, didn't want to pardon people, made you look soft on crime maybe. Trump has went the opposite, pardoned a lot of folks, pardoned folks on his way out. I think it might have helped even Mike Parson pardon some people in December. And now one of your constituents, Jennifer Bukowski, and Rex Singfield have said, why don't you look at that clemency list? It is pretty long in the state.
Yeah, I mean, I think the tide has shifted, public perception has shifted around what it means to be tough and or smart on crime. And so, yeah, you know, I think I want to live in a world where people have a chance at grace, have a chance at a second chance. Doesn't mean that laws don't exist. It doesn't mean that punishments for laws don't exist, but it does mean that in instances, specifically as it relates to nonviolent crimes, that there are chances to get a second chance. And, you know, when those things happen, when those moments arise, I think it's good for any president, any governor, take a look at it and try to throw grace out there when it can be had.
Capitol's quiet today, not just because of the increased police presence. The House isn't in session this week because of COVID issues. Yeah. Walk me through how you thought about, do you have session or not, and walk me through how you ultimately decided to be here this week.
Yeah, we got on a call. You know, I think the House made that announcement late last week. We got on a call last Friday. Talk to the caucus. They wanted to be here. We have the luxury of, there are fewer of us, obviously. We are able to distance pretty much anywhere we want to be, whereas the House, especially in the House chamber, just doesn't really have the ability to do that. So it's easier for us. You know, we felt like we could get a few committees through the process, get some gubernatorial appointments done. You know, we feel confident that we can be here. We're safe. Folks are healthy, they're getting tested, and if there are issues, they go home. So we feel good about where we're at.
Talk about the state's response to COVID. I like how the governor's been tweeting out how any 100,000 Missourians have had the vaccine already. What is your observation of how the state's handled the vaccine rollout?
Yeah, I think we're getting there. You know, there was a little bit of uncertainty as to, you know, who was in what tier initially, so we got some constituent contacts from that. But I think we're getting to a point now where I think people understand the process. And you know, I think generally the governor's folks have done a good job. You know, there's always going to be people who need it that don't have ready access to it, at least in the initial stages. And we've got to be prepared for that and do everything that we can, you know, to make sure that, that group of people is as small as possible. And you know, we're going to have probably some you know, issues with access to the actual vaccination, and so we'll get there. But you know, it's going to require everybody to be as patient, as flexible as possible, because this is not something that anybody had planned for, you know, outside of a couple of months ago.
Let me ask you the question. When it comes time, I know you'll probably be down on the list. Both of us probably aren't anywhere near the top of getting a vaccine anytime soon. When it comes time and it's available to you, will you take the vaccine?
Yeah, I'll take it. And, you know, I think I'm not in any rush to do it. There are people who need it far more than I am. 38 years old and I think relatively healthy. So, you know, I think the notion of us jumping a list because we're in public office and, you know, Congress people tweeting about getting the vaccine, like, kind of rubs me the wrong way. I don't care if they do it. You know, everybody's capable of making their own decisions, but, you know, there's a lot of people who need it more than I do.
Let's talk real quickly about issues. You mentioned a couple things may come up in the Senate next week. You've talked about education reform. What does that look like? And explain that. I mean, in Columbia, maybe they're a little more plugged in than other places, yeah. But if you're just a guy in Wardsville or you're a guy in Vienna, what does that mean to you?
Well, I think it probably means a little bit, maybe it's different than it was last year. I do think COVID has exposed some pretty glaring insufficiencies in how we're educating our kids. And in moments of trial, you know, maybe I think kids have suffered probably more than anybody else throughout this COVID window. So we're trying to do two things. There's clearly stuff that we wanted to do for a long time. I think the expansion of charter schools, giving parents more influence and more control over their dollars as it relates to their kids, those are things that we want to do and have wanted to do for a long time. But also, you know, finding where those holes that got exposed are, and figuring out ways to give public schools new tools, new resources, more flexibility as it relates to a situation like this. But also, most of the time, we found that when regulations go away inside of a pandemic, we find that we probably didn't really need that regulation to begin with, right? So so I think there's some of that. I think the notion, I'll say it as loud as I can, the notion that me believing in this stuff or anybody believing in school choice makes me anti-public education is one of the most glaring, gross, insufficient generalities that anybody can have, and it's what makes politics worse. And so hopefully we can get past that.
So with your reforms, you're talking about giving public schools more tools?
I want to do both. I mean, I think the notion that, and the public schools have done a good job, public school folks that lobby down here have done a good job of saying that if you are for one, you can't be for the other. I'm for both. It just so happens they're for one and not for the other. I'm for both. I want public schools to succeed because, as you mentioned, Wardsville, Vienna, wherever else, there's never going to be a charter school in that community, right? There's never going to be really any option outside of maybe a parochial here or there, but they're going to public schools. So those public schools need to be great. They need to be better than they've ever been before. And so I want to do a better job here of giving those folks tools and resources and flexibility to do their job as the best they can do it.
Question I've been hit with is, if there's not going to be one in Reynolds County, then why don't you just keep in St. Louis and Kansas City?
Well, I think there are other places. I think Columbia needs a charter school, and I'm not shy to say that. They may need a couple. I think, you know, I think Greene County would benefit from a few. I think St. Louis County would benefit from a few. So, I mean, I think the notion that they're good in St. Louis and Kansas City and don't need to go anywhere else, I think that that does an injustice to kids in other areas that need some. So I think charters go where there is a need, according to, you know, parent involvement and influence. And you're never going to see that in those rural communities like that.
Last thing is COVID liability. What does that actually mean to a regular person?
Yeah, I mean, I think it means that folks who employ on the front lines of the response to COVID, whether it's a healthcare individual, healthcare entity, a business who is trying to figure out how we can get back to work and get back in business without being scared to death that if somebody walks in and gets COVID from somebody else inside their business, that all of a sudden they're liable and, you know, are going to be sued out of existence. It is simply meant to provide clarity for the business that will absolutely transfer down to the employer, the employee, you know, folks who are buying goods and services from those folks. It's meant to provide some stability we never knew this was going to happen, and so we never thought this was a thing. Clearly, it has become a thing, and so we're trying to make sure that our laws reflect now the back end of COVID and, you know, getting out of this mess in a way that can keep our economy strong.
I asked you this question almost a year ago now in Columbia when I come and interviewed you on our live stream. When do you see a time when folks might start to feel normal again?
You know, I think it's coming. In Columbia, obviously, you know, is a liberal community generally. I mean, but other than people walking around with masks on, I think it's felt pretty normal for a number of months. Now, I know there are people whose lives have been impacted in different ways than mine have. But I think we're heading the right direction. Obviously, I think the distribution of the vaccine makes people feel more confident and comfortable being out, even if they have it or don't have it. And so, I think we're getting there. We're on the right track. And I don't like to live in fear. I don't want to be stupid. I don't want to do things that jeopardize myself or people around me. But I also, you know, Scripture says don't live in fear, and there's a reason for that. And so that's a difficult balance to find in a moment like this, but it's one that I've tried to find, and I think we're getting there as a society.
Part of that normal feels like when the Missouri Senate, which you couldn't be in session for a lot of last session, but you're back this session.
Yeah, and we're going to try to be here as often as we can. I mean, we got a lot of stuff to do. Obviously, the response to COVID, both monetary, you know, tools and resources, financially and otherwise, we got a lot of stuff to do. We got our work cut out for us, and you know, we got a great group of new folks, new senators, Republican, Democrat, who are ready and eager to work. So we're excited.
Last question I have is, as a floor leader, you decide what bills you go to for the most part. What if you have a senator that really is passionate about filibustering something or passing something, and they get COVID? How do you handle that?
You know, it's a good question. I think we'll probably take it as it comes. I am not going.
Is it easier to answer in January when you have 5 months of session
left?
Yeah, and
I can say definitively, I'm not going to use a pandemic to push forward an agenda, whether it's mine or anybody else's. So I mean, if COVID causes a snafu that we didn't expect, we've got to be flexible. I've got to be flexible. We've got to be willing to call audibles as needed, and I think we'll be ready to do that.
Senator, thank you for your time.
Thank you, sir.
We'll be right back with our opinion maker panel. The Prince of St. James, Jack Cardetti, joins us after this.
All across Missouri, our new car and truck dealers are building strong local economies. When you buy a car or truck in Missouri, you're helping to support over 20,000 Missouri families who rely on the auto industry for good-paying local jobs. You're also helping fund our communities, schools, first responders, and our roads, because dealers generate millions of dollars in tax revenue. Missouri's automobile dealers have been the foundation of our communities for generations and for generations to come. The Missouri Automobile Dealers Association, the heart of Missouri.
For more than a century, the St. Louis Carpenters Union has shaped our communities. Through trusted alliances, we deliver skilled professional craftspeople while our business partners provide the kind of quality jobs that keep our economy humming. It's a blueprint that has worked since 1882. Turning Missouri into a right-to-work state stalls progress, wipes out jobs, and kills momentum. Right-to-work is wrong for everyone. Let's keep Missouri moving forward. Visit carpdc.org to learn more.
Your energy needs are changing. That's why at Ameren Missouri, we're not waiting on the future. We're building it with the Smart Energy Plan, advancing thousands of projects across the state, helping reduce emissions through cleaner energy sources, boost reliability with self-healing equipment, and better withstand storms with new composite poles. Moving Missouri forward and bringing us all a little closer together. That's energy at work. Ameren, Missouri.
Welcome back to This Week in Missouri Politics. Opinion maker panel time here from the state capitol. James Harris from Franklin County. I saw this week there was a Franklin County carrying Nancy Pelosi's. That wasn't any kin to you, right?
No relative.
Senator Justin Brown from Phelps County, welcome back.
Glad to be here.
Senator Barbara Washington, Kansas City, welcome back.
Thanks for fitting me in.
And the Prince of, we have a Phelps County heavy panel here. The Prince of Phelps County, Jack Cardetti, thank you for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
Inauguration had to be kind of a fun day to watch.
Yeah, I actually think this year's inauguration probably took on more prominence than usual, you know, because of the attack you had a couple weeks ago, led by Missouri's own Josh Hawley. I think the peaceful transfer of power is something as Americans we take for granted. And I think it renewed everybody's interest in the inauguration. Well, it was a great day for Democrats.
Last year, the largest crowd ever that had watched an inauguration in 4 years ago, not this year, I assume.
Well, actually, Obama, I think, had the largest crowd, but small hands would probably debate that.
Senator Brown, I have always thought Republicans had the upper hand on law and order and things. And when you think of protests, and you think of a protest that maybe does turn violent, you don't think of those as Republicans. It was shocking to see those people in the Capitol. And I think maybe Inauguration Day is a little more special to try to put that as far back in the memory as you can have it.
Right. And as Jack said, you know, Scott, the transition of power the peaceful transition of power is a very important part of the American experience. And what we saw today is not a foregone conclusion of the events that happened 2 weeks ago, but I am very glad that the inauguration went off peaceful and safe.
Senator, you walked through here the same day, out on the lawn here at the Missouri Capitol, and there were people protesting. I've never been a big protester myself. I don't know exactly what they were protesting that Trump really won. Now, I didn't feel unsafe because they were here.
Now, I'll be very transparent. I didn't walk out, so I did not realize that we had people here until I left. And I really wouldn't say that those that were here at our Capitol that day were necessarily protesting. I think we have to delineate when there is a gathering, there are rallies where people are there in support, and there are protests when people are there in opposition of something. Okay. I think with our state being a supermajority in terms of our elected officials being Republicans, I looked at those people as I saw them as I was leaving more as a rally of support of President Trump and our governor and our elected officials here than protesting anything. They were peaceful. To me, for the 5 or 6 minutes that I watched them, and which is what you should be. So I didn't look at them as necessarily a protest. I don't think a gathering of people automatically means a protest, because I'll be honest, today, had people been allowed to be there, there probably would have been, just from my civic organization, over 100,000 women that would have been there, and that would not have been a protest. That would have been a rally in support of the vice president today.
James, from your window on High Street, you could probably almost see, you could certainly see people walking down to where the rally, I think it was probably a better term, as a rally, but you turn your TV on and you see people in the Capitol. I never see anything like that.
Neither did I. And people here, I actually walked by just going back to my office, and they were people from, we might see at Walmart or anywhere else in the state, yep. And they just came to talk, and what happened was disappointing in Washington, D.C. Hopefully, though, at some point, we're not there yet, but our elected officials will pause and go, you know, the rhetoric's become more heated, more visceral for probably 20 years, and, you know, we all love America, and what can we do to begin changing that dialogue to make more of a civil dialogue back and forth, because, you know, we're on a bad path, and we need to figure out, and we all have a responsibility, and our elected officials do, how do we change that?
Jack, I totally agree with that. There's something, and I don't know if it's social media. I do feel like we're on a bad path where you can't talk to people. And I love doing this show because generally the folks on here, you can talk. But I'm not sure if you took, when they used to have the Medicaid rallies here, when they were going to cut Medicaid, those folks were a different type of person. I don't know if those folks could talk to the folks at a Trump rally. And I think it's a bad, in my gut, it feels like we're on a bad path.
Well, yeah, and I think part of it's they're working off of two completely different sets of information, right?
Yeah.
We used to have the same information in this country, and then we would debate about what do we do, what does it mean, what do we do, where do we go forward, what policies that need to come out of that. Here, we can't even agree on facts, right? The fact that this big lie, the fact that Donald Trump somehow won this election, quite frankly, in my adult lifetime, this is one of the more lopsided presidential context tests that we've had. He didn't come anywhere close. He lost by 7 million votes, lost by tons of electoral votes. But the fact that he was able to then institute, with the help of people like Josh Hawley, the big lie, and actually get hundreds of thousands of people to rally around that and try to take action against their government, really concerning. We need to get back to where we agree on a simple set of facts. We might have different opinions on the solution, but we agree what is actually happening.
You know, James, it's 5 years ago. You call me up and tell me about this guy, very talented. He's gonna run for AG, he's gonna win. I'm like, whatever, James, no way. Guy comes on, wins the race, takes on the U.S. Senate race, just dominated that race, being talked about running for president. Now, I mean, as Jack said, I think that that opinion is held by a lot of Democrats. It's probably not been a good 2 weeks for him. How's he feeling? What is his plan going forward?
Well, I think Senator Hawley was standing up for after listening to constituents, a lot of people that did have concerns about the election or election integrity. I think his future is very bright. I think he will continue to articulate what I think the majority of Missourians want as far as someone standing up for, whether it's the forgotten person, standing up for pro-life, pro-Second Amendment ideas, conservative stuff. And I think his future is very bright. He's a very intelligent person. You know, I think people, it's easy to blame and say this person said something and that, and assign blame. But again, if we're going back, it's not his fault what happened. There were some people that had bad actions, and they should be prosecuted.
You know, to me, I think that we all want to think we're in the most important time ever. You know, the Democrats have every level of power in the federal government. It's the kind of thing that 6 months from now, Josh Hawley's probably not. There's going to be some people who throw this at him for the rest of his career. But as far as like a regular Missourian, I think you might see the Biden administration or the House majority do things Missourians don't like. And I think Josh Hawley will be in a good place to recuperate whatever he might have lost with that set of cards.
Just like Democrats did 12 years ago. By the time you got to cap and trade and Obamacare, everything had changed. Yeah. So that's a very good point.
Senator Brown, you are a big advocate in the Senate of statesmanship, of finding a way to communicate with people on a respectful level. The Senate's prided itself on that for the most part my entire lifetime. How do you take some of the way the Senate is and try to see that reflected in society more?
Well, you know, I'm not going to sit here and lie that I don't have concerns of what this new administration coming in newly elected President Biden and some of the policies, especially regarding taxation. But, you know, today, I think as Americans, we need to, get behind the president, pray for him, and wish him well on his endeavor of this new administration.
I'll ask you the question I asked Senator Rauten. Do you believe Joe Biden won the election?
I do.
Yeah, I think that's, there are folks that will argue that, but I'm not sure that you're, if you go to Lincoln Day season's coming up, and it'd probably be a little different this year, but at the Lincoln Day season, I'm not sure you're going to see folks at the Lincoln Day that truly believe that he didn't win the election. I think most Republicans, they did. Now you're going to find your social media kooks, but for the most part, he won the election. Now maybe there were some problems, but he won the election.
Right. I think there were some problems, and I think that we need to continue to make sure that the integrity of our elections are not compromised, but I do believe he won the election.
And Senator Washington, I think that Jay Ashcroft did a pretty good job overseeing the elections. I mean,
I
Missouri,
think he
these
did.
Are local efforts, but he did fine.
But I think what has been overshadowed with a couple of points. Agreeing with Senator Brown that we need to pray for the new president. But listen to some of what he said. I mean, it's a totally different inaugural speech today, that the first thing he said is, I am the president for all of America. There are no blue states, no blue cities, no blue counties, no red counties. We are all Americans, and whomever elects you. You know, I won my county. I beat Trump and governor and every other Republican in my county. My own congressman lost my county, but it doesn't matter. I still represent everyone in Jackson County that lives within my boundaries. I think we take what President Biden said today and remember that the strength of who we are is that we are proud to be Americans, regardless of what your beliefs are. And we must remember that this has totally overshadowed this falsehood that this was a stolen election, that President Trump has never won the popular vote. In fact, I can't personally remember the last time a Republican won the popular vote. So let's remember that, and that this is the most secure election because of the non-secure election we had in 2016, where we, Republican committees determined that there was some interference. The one thing I thank President Trump for is you pulled the wool off of the people's eyes and realized that we got work to do in this state, in this country. And if we can really work to unify ourselves, grab onto that one thing that makes us proud to be American, makes us proud to have freedom of speech, freedom of religion, and unfortunately we lost it, but the freedom of the press is in the Constitution.
Senator, if we do that, we can heal. You don't want her opposing it because she could do this well. I mean, just real quick before we go, the Senate decided to be in. The halls are a little quieter. That's why we can do this here because the House isn't here. You were on that phone call where the Senate leadership got together and said, we're going to come in and have session. What was that like? And I think they made the right decision.
Well, I think we made the right decision. You know, we try to do things, and it's easier for us, and the majority on our side of the Capitol and the Senate. You know, there's 24 of us to make the decision, so a little easier to do that by phone. And it was unanimous. You know, we decided that we were going to be here this week. You know, not to say that we're not going to be careful.
Moved some pretty big bills through committees.
Right.
And it wasn't a wasted week at all.
We did. So, you know, we want to try to set an example of, you know, we need to, you know, not, you know, do the right thing, get back to work, you know, respect other people's offices, whether it's, you know, masking, social distancing, you know, wash your hands, you know, be careful, but it's time for us to, you know, to try to get back to normal as close as we possibly can.
With that, Jack Cardetti, who won the week?
I mean, I think our daughters won the week, quite frankly. You know, the really historic event today, have the not only the first female vice president ever, but African-American female president in Kamala Harris. I think it's great for the country, and I think it's great for our daughters everywhere to see that.
Senator, who won the week?
I think Hope won the week.
How does because, it about your sorority?
Well, I mean, that's a given. I think honestly what you're gonna see is HBCUs are gonna win the week because this is the first time ever that a graduate of a historically black college will be in the White House. I mean, we only had two black people, so.
Yeah.
But I think they will win. In fact, my computer in my office is going now with a Zoom call that I'm hosting with members of another organization she's in. Called the Links Incorporated, and on my phone was Alpha Kappa Alpha Zoom. Our international president has been very involved and supportive of Senator Harris.
Awesome.
I'm sorry, Madam Vice President.
Yeah, there you go.
So I think HBCUs will win the week. Alpha Kappa Alpha has been around for 113 years. We're proud, but you know that ain't gonna make more. This isn't gonna make more people come. But what it will do is it will sustain. Are historically black colleges and universities because you have someone in there that understands the importance and takes the stigma off that being a second class institution.
Senator, who won the week?
Reverend Carl Gock, chaplain of the Missouri State Senate. The last couple of weeks, you know, we've been talking about it here in the last few minutes about how trying it has been for the country and the state. And Reverend Gock has not taken his eye off the ball and trying to, in every prayer that he leads every day the last 2 weeks, of being unified no matter what side of the aisle you're on. We're all Americans. That's why we're being, you know, sitting here being able to have this conversation. So I really appreciate Reverend Gock.
Absolutely. Who won the week?
Senator Roy Blunt, for running a successful, safe inauguration today, and in the era of COVID, that adds a lot more complications and challenges.
State's got a lot to be proud of with Senator Blunt. I'm going to say I think the Senate won the week. I think Senator Schott, Senator Rowden being here, planning it out and having session, it feels more normal when things are back to normal. And being here in the Capitol, talking about bills you guys are moving, I think is the right way to go. Hope you'll win the week next week by joining us back in our studios in St. Louis for This Week in Missouri Politics.
This Week in Missouri Politics, sponsored by the Missouri Association of Career Fire Protection Districts, SPIRE, and Sterling Bank.